Good morning, everyone, and you're very welcome to this morning's webinar hosted by IMS on behalf of the HSE, Social Prescribing in Ireland. While we let the numbers build in the background, just a little bit of housekeeping from our side. There is a Q&A button. You're in Zoom webinar format, so there is a Q&A button, and we'd like you to use this as much as possible throughout the event, and we'll endeavour to answer those questions in the background. There's a team answering questions, and also we have built in some time at the end of the session for some live Q&A. So without further ado, I hope you enjoy this morning. I'm going to hand you over to your host, Anne Sheridan.
Good morning, everyone. And I'm really delighted to welcome you to this webinar on social prescribing, building the evidence base. My name is Anne Sheridan, and I am the program manager for mental health and wellbeing within health and wellbeing in the HSE. And I'm really, really delighted and thrilled that so many of you have been able to join us here this morning for what I really think is going to be a really interesting session and event for all of you, hopefully. So you actually represent a really wide audience. We have a lot of people here from research and academia, people from the HSE, from the Department of Health, from the community and voluntary sector, as well as link workers and social prescribing coordinators, as they're sometimes called, who really represent the heart and soul of social prescribing. So you're all really, really welcome. We have an interesting program, and you see it there on your screen. So we're going to kick off very shortly with the first presentation from Dr. Stephanie O'Keefe. She will be followed by a pre-recorded session from done by Dr. Michael Dixon. And then we are having, it's actually not there, but there's actually a video where someone who's experienced social prescribing is actually talking about what that experience has been like. Eamon Sedak and Jennifer Neff have been the two people who've actually completed the study and written the report that we're launching today. So you're going to hear from Eamon at that point. And then the report will be launched by Minister Frank Feehan. So we're delighted to be joined by him as well. And finally, we have a panel discussion, and we have five panelists, and I'll introduce those to you when the time comes. So hopefully this is a program that's going to hold your interest for the next hour and a half. The purpose of the webinar, of course, is to launch the evaluability study on social prescribing. And this is a project of work that took place in the last quarter or so of last year and the first few months of 2020. We had planned a more traditional launch, which was due to take place actually in June of this year. But when COVID-19 struck, that made that impossible. So at this point, I would like to really acknowledge the work and contribution of both Eamon Sedak and Jennifer Neff, who were awarded the contract to complete this study. And you'll be hearing from Eamon very shortly. Just like to say at the outset that over the last few years, there's been an unprecedented growth in social prescribing in this country. And that's really been supported by Sláintecare and also by funding from Healthy Ireland. The background to the study that we're launching today is really that growing movement of social prescribing and the need to build a really robust evidence base here in Ireland for social prescribing. It was agreed very early on that the study really should look at the current landscape of social prescribing here in Ireland and engage with all of the stakeholders who are involved to find out, first of all, what data is actually being collected at the moment by the various projects that are up and running, and for what purpose is that data being collected, and really what level of evaluation did everybody feel was both viable and achievable within social prescribing here in Ireland. We had a group actually overseeing this entire study, and I'll just name the people in that group at the moment. So Orla Walsh from Health and Wellbeing, Gemma Cox from the National Office on Suicide Prevention, Sarah Gibney from the Department of Health, and Deirdre Connolly from Trinity College Dublin. And so I'd like to thank them for seeing this project through to its end. And I'd also like to acknowledge the National Office for Suicide Prevention, who, along with Health and Wellbeing in HSE, co-funded this study in the first place. So you've all received copies of the report in the last few days, and I hope that you've had a chance to have an initial look through that. And I'd like to thank you, those of you who've actually submitted some questions ahead of today. We'll come to those later on in the panel discussion. But for now, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, who is Dr. Stephanie O'Keefe, National Director for Strategic Planning and Transformation in the HSE. In her current role, Stephanie is responsible for corporate and national planning in the HSE, and in addition to the healthcare transformation. And as part of this role, she's established the first research and evidence function in the HSE, where there's a 10-year action plan and research currently being implemented. And in her role within the HSE, Stephanie has also been hugely involved in the HSE response to COVID-19. So Stephanie, you're very welcome this morning, and I'll hand over to you now.
Thank you very, very much, Eamon, and thank you to everybody for joining this morning. And you're all very welcome to this kind of fairly now common platform that we're using to make sure that the work continues and that we share ideas and get on with doing the things that are all very, very dear to us. And you're very welcome for a fairly kind of drizzly and kind of wet day in Dublin. And thank you particularly to all of our expert speakers who have joined us and indeed to Minister Frank Fain for agreeing to launch the report this morning. From my perspective, in terms of being responsible for health and wellbeing policy implementation within the HSE, for us, social prescribing is all about building the coalition of support for this agenda across different sectors, building on the expertise of many people, both within the health sector and outside, very much outside of the health sector, so as to be able to really, I suppose, grow the vision for social prescribing, which is all about building Ireland's kind of social capital, economic capital, and all of the investments that we make to support people to live healthier lives with the best lives that they can, really, with higher levels of health and wellbeing. And we want to make sure that this work becomes much more embedded, which is why Anne and the team are taking the approach that they are. When we set out looking at this area a number of years ago, it's fair to say that there's considerable levels of complexity, lots of different types of programs, very hard to compare and contrast, and from an investment perspective, very challenging. So this work is really about trying to work significantly more collaboratively, cross-sectorally, with a common framework and a common platform for this type of work, so that we can try to demonstrate and be fairly robust ourselves with regard to how it works and where it works. I think that what's also embedded this work that's been really important is the voice of the service users, the people who are using this type of approach, and who are benefiting from this type of approach and trying through these types of frameworks with more robust evaluation to embed those experiences and those voices into that work. And we've got lots of really good examples of this, and I think the team have gone to good lengths to be able to have some of those voices there today, and we'd hope to be able to hear that in the feedback session later on. It's really important as well that we've got our colleagues that we work very collaboratively with in the Department of Health today, and they're speaking, and the whole area of health and wellbeing from a policy perspective within the Department of Health is being led by the Sláinte Care Implementation Office now, and by Laura McGahey. And this is a wonderful positive development. The Sláinte Care programme very much endorses the Healthy Ireland approach and the approach to health and wellbeing that we're taking cross-sectorally, with the health service playing a very significant advocacy role in relation to improving population health, reducing health inequalities, protecting the public from threats to health, and no better a time than having a global pandemic to try and do that one, and enabling every sector to play its part. So that is an intrinsic kind of core set of objectives within the Sláinte Care framework. And now that is being led in conjunction with health and wellbeing within the Department of Health. That's a really wonderful development. And we know also that in the recent past that there has been some additional funding for social prescribing work, both some of the mainstream programmes to embed them further and for other additional flagship programmes across the country. And that's very much to be supported. And I think this work that Anne is leading with Orla and with a number of other partners and colleagues to try to support, again, that framework for evaluation and the framework for how these services and initiatives can be deployed to greater effect is the whole purpose of today's launch. Within the HSE, we've established a multidisciplinary group with representation across divisions and with the community and voluntary sector and with patient voice. And I really look forward to seeing how we can bring this agenda, how we can make this agenda stronger into the future and see lots more social prescribing initiatives happening around the country with some of our traditional partners, being very active within that, from our GPs to our practice nurses, to all of our health and social care professionals within the health sector, but also with our partners who are leading this agenda in other sectors through local authorities, through the community and voluntary sector, and with our Age Friendly Ireland programme and so on and so forth. So thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you to the staff for continuing with this work. I think that certainly from a health sector's perspective, but not only from a health sector perspective, we have we've very much been focusing on our response to COVID. We know that COVID has had a significant impact in terms of health and wellbeing across the country, and that there's been an inequitable distribution of that also. So these types of initiatives are actually really important in the context of the work that we're doing with regard to COVID, in terms of ensuring that the show is kept on the road and that we're supporting people with the challenges that they're experiencing from a health and wellbeing perspective, and referring them in the right direction to services that can support. So thank you very much, and I wish you all the very best of luck with the rest of the day.
Thank you very much, Stephanie, and thank you for your ongoing leadership and support in really helping us to progress social prescribing within the HSE. Thank you. So we have a great opportunity to learn from experiences across the water, particularly in the UK, and the developments that have been happening there in recent years in relation to social prescribing. So I'd now like to introduce Dr. Michael Dixon. He's a Devon GP who holds numerous leadership roles, including Chair of the College of Medicine and Clinical Champion for Social Prescribing in NHS England, just to name a couple. Michael is also visiting professor at University College London and at the University of Westminster. Michael pre-recorded his input a few days ago, but luckily for us, he's here with us live today, and he's going to participate in the panel discussion later on. But for now, I'll hand over to his pre-recorded input.
Good morning, and it's a real pleasure to be here at the launch of the Social Prescribing National Evaluation Framework. And I have to say, here in the Republic of Ireland, and I'm very sorry that I'm not on the right side of the Irish Channel today, you are right ahead of the game. Apart from the United Kingdom, you're the first nation to take on social prescribing as a national element in health and social care. And we've worked over this side of the Irish Channel closely with David and also with Dave Robinson and Tony Doherty. They are both visiting fellows to our Social Prescribing Institute, and that has been asked over the next few years to develop an international quorum of people engaged in social prescribing. So in the Republic, you are right up there with the leaders in social prescription, and thank you so much for what you're doing, because we're learning much from you as much as vice versa. I thought it might be helpful just in a minute or two to give you a briefing on what's been happening here in the United Kingdom and some of the challenges that we're facing. So first of all, over the summer, there's been a further recruitment drive for social prescribing link workers, and shortly we'll have a social prescribing link worker in every group of GP practices called a primary care network. In fact, in some there'll be two, And our aim is over the next few years to have two or three per network covering approximately 40,000 to 50,000 patients. We've had the launch only recently of the National Academy of Social Prescribing, which is a charity launched by the NHS, and which will be looking particularly at bringing different areas of government together on social prescribing, whether it's the environment, social, media, transport, justice, and also at how we develop the voluntary sector. We've got our own National Association of Link Workers. We continue with the national network of social prescribing, of which David and Tony are members, and which is, as I say, going increasingly international. And just recently, I was invited to chair and set up a National Institute for Social Prescribing, which is looking at how we innovate and how we test ideas and how we spread them. So a lot going on there over, well, literally, we started probably only 3 or 4 years ago, November 2016. I remember a small group of us deciding that social prescribing was something we wanted to bring onto the national stage, and that's how things have developed since. So I thought it might be worth going through some of the issues we're facing, because I suspect they're very similar to the issues that you're facing in the Republic. And perhaps the biggest single issue is how we develop the offer that these link workers and social prescribing are referring their patients to. That's to say, how do we develop the voluntary sector and the volunteers so that we've got sufficient capacity to meet the demands of social prescribing? And this has been quite a problem during COVID, with a lot of the middle-sized voluntary agencies actually being quite financially challenged and some even closing down. And that's something the Academy is going to be working very hard on. The other issue, which I understand is quite a big one with yourselves in Ireland, is how we persuade and inspire our GP colleagues and primary care generally to take a less biomedical and a more psychosocial attitude towards medicine, which makes social prescribing a centre part of it. Having champions is important. Also, explain to some of our colleagues the advantages in terms of what we're finding is where social prescribing is going well in the UK, the whole community works better, and it's easier to get doctors, nurses, and people working in primary care, and there's a general morale raiser as a result of that. A big issue during COVID has been inequalities, not only because the less well off have often been those that have suffered from COVID, but also from the problems of having to isolate during COVID. And a particular issue here is about digital inequalities. And I think that we're going to need to work closely from here on, in particular after COVID, with how we address those digital inequalities, especially given the fact that so much of social prescription at present in the UK is having to be digital. Volunteers have come out of the woodwork massively in the UK. We had 750,000 volunteers for the NHS volunteer scheme, and many locally. One problem is going to be how we keep those volunteers coming up post-COVID. But a particular issue has been how we coordinate them. And we're sort of creating a new animal in some of the cities in the UK, who you might call a volunteer facilitator, who makes sure that the right volunteers are going to help the right people. In some areas, these are actually volunteers themselves, so facilitators of volunteers. And what we're seeing is developing tapestry of social prescribing, where you've got your link worker, who is the base unit of social prescribing, but also often they or someone else are taking on two other roles. One is in, if you might say, building up social capital locally, the community development, to increase the number of offers available to that link worker. And then this third role, which I've just described, which is of a volunteer facilitator, making sure that you're maximising the use of all the voluntary effort we've got locally, and that we've got that voluntary effort there in the first place. The only other thing I wanted to mention is social prescribing developing increasingly away, well, not away, from its base, which is very much people with mental health problems, with social problems, the elderly, and increasingly looking at children, particularly in the UK, and adolescents, particularly beginning to look at other people, such as, I know in Belfast, social prescribing is now offered in a women's prison, and I think this is a real area for expansion, as it is with the homeless and a large number of other groups which we need to start taking social prescription to. And I'd also say we need to take it upstream generally, because too often we are taking social prescription to people with many long-term diseases. But actually, maybe the best benefit of social prescription is to take it at the point at which a patient is getting that first long-term disease, as a means of stopping them going to the second, third, fourth, and fifth, and really, if you like, getting there at an earlier stage. So increasingly we're finding that social prescription is the tapestry of primary care, and almost is relevant to a very large number of patient encounters. I won't say every, but an increasing number. And I think this is what clinicians and workers are finding. And perhaps our problem at the end of the day will be a capacity problem, not one of trying to persuade clinicians of importance. And then finally, the point of today, which is about evaluation. So crucial to know what we're doing, to get proper feedback on success, and also to know where social prescription is going to be most effective for whom and how. And clearly, there needs to be some local sensitivity about that, because in every case, the evaluation needs to be relevant to the patient, their problem, and the particular intervention involved. But so that we don't end up comparing apples and pears, it's so important that we also have a national evaluation framework, and that there is that conversation going on between national priorities and national information and local priorities and the sort of things that people feel are important locally. So, congratulations on today. It's a real first. It's been a real pleasure to be with you, and I've been to take great interest in listening to the conversations during the day.
Thank you. That was really, really interesting. And so interesting to hear that the audience, the potential audience for social prescribing, is expanding all the time. Also, Dr. Dixon mentioned there that he has an international role now in relation to social prescribing. So we really look forward to very actively collaborating with him and into the future. But as I say, you're going to hear more from Dr. Dixon in person in the panel discussion later. Okay, so for now, what we move on to is a short video clip from a person who has benefited and has attended social prescribing. So I look forward to and hope you enjoy this, because it's always really great to hear from someone who has the lived experience of the benefits that social prescribing can actually deliver.
So when my GP told me about social prescribing, I was actually waiting a very long time to see a psychiatrist who was going to put me on medication for my depression. And that's partly why I was interested in social prescribing, because it was something else that could help me in the meantime. And when I finally got onto some medication, I still was doing social prescribing, and now at the moment I am no longer on medication and I'm still doing social prescribing, and it's still working for me. Okay. The first time I met with my social prescriber, I was a bit apprehensive because I didn't know what I was coming to. I didn't know what a social prescriber was. So I was really, really nervous, and I felt like it was felt like I had nobody else really to turn to, because I had tried everything else, and I didn't realize how much a social prescriber could do for you. Well, I have a daughter, and she's only a year and a half, And when I met with my social prescriber, that was almost a year ago, or just over a year ago, actually. And she referred me to a class called Tiny Tunes because I didn't really know of anything that was going on for kids. So I took her to that and she loved it. And it was great because I got to really bond with her at the class. And I got to meet loads of new parents because I live in a very remote place, and in that way I got to meet the whole town just by going to the Tiny Tunes. So after I've seen my social prescriber and everything was brilliant in my life, but unfortunately I kind of took a relapse and things started to go amiss with me. So I decided to go back to see my social prescriber, and that was the best thing I could have done because it worked for me before, and that's why I was so ready to go back to see my social prescriber. And thank God I did, because she was able to put me in the right direction again. I'm busy now. I used to never be busy, and now I'm always doing something, and I'm always smiling, I'm always meeting new people, and I'm just always happy. In the time that I've been attending social prescribing, I've grown more in that short period of time than in my whole life. I'm a changed person. I would recommend it to everyone. It's the best thing I ever done.
Okay.
It really is.
Well, it's really hard to beat hearing from someone who's actually experienced social prescribing. And I think it just is a huge reminder of just the impact that social prescribing can have on a person's life. So we're really grateful to the person who made that video to let us hear what her experience was. Okay, you've all received a copy of the report called Building Capacity for the Evaluation of Social Prescribing, which is the work of our next speaker, Eamon Sedag, and his colleague Jennifer Neff. Eamon and Jennifer were commissioned by the HSE to complete this study and write this report. And Jennifer will participate in the panel discussion later, but for now I'd like to welcome Eamon, who will talk us through the main findings from his study. Thank you, Eamon.
Thanks, Anne. If you could just bear with me, I'm going to share a screen, so hopefully we've got a few slides we can talk through. So thanks a million, Anne, and good morning, everyone. What a hugely impactful video that was, and so relevant to what we're about to present. Delighted to be here on behalf of our own company, S3 Solutions, and Elemental, who we work with on the evaluability assessment, to share some findings with you. I suppose to get started, just a very brief recap on the project brief and what we were actually commissioned to do. So there are three objectives to the overall report. Number one was to provide an overview of the current social prescribing landscape in Ireland. Number two was then to make a judgment on the extent to which social prescribing can be evaluated in a reliable or credible fashion. And number three, and based on the findings of the evaluability assessment, to provide some recommendations on how to establish a system to collate and report on social prescribing outcomes. So the plan for this presentation, there's lots of information, hopefully as you've gathered in the report, but the plan here is to present or address each of the objectives in a short but comprehensive way. And very briefly, I suppose, just to give you a sense of our approach to the project, it was very much based on having conversations, speaking to as many people as we can about social prescribing. And in that way, we conducted site visits to 12 projects located at the length and breadth of Ireland, within which we visited link workers, we spoke to some participants, we spoke to some primary care professionals, coordinators from community voluntary organisations. We carried out other interviews with funders, commissioners, those involved in the research and evaluation of social prescribing. And many, like many of you here, we attended the conference in December in Waterford, as well as regional events around social prescribing. And I suppose that the focus of those conversations for us was really an exploration of how social prescribing was being delivered. How did the projects evolve? What data is currently being collected? And what challenges and barriers might exist? And also what opportunities are there and how do people view evaluation going forward? So overall across the project, more than 280 people were exposed to, engaged in, or contributed to the discussion, and we're really proud of that. So in terms of objective one around the social prescribing landscape, Anne's already referenced this, and I'm sure you can tell from the attendance here today, it's no secret, social prescribing is growing in Ireland. When our work started off initially in August, September 2019, we started with a list of 12 projects that were delivering social prescribing. But during the course of the research, the number of known social prescribing projects increased. And we estimate there's now in the region of 18 to 20 projects that are operating in Ireland of Ireland or in the Republic of Ireland, and the All Ireland Social Prescribing Network is growing. Social prescribing has now got a place in strategy and policy, and Sláinte Care has funded a number of projects. And I think there are 9 or 10 different references to social prescribing in the Department for Health's mental health policy, sharing the vision. At a project level, I suppose the delivery models are largely based on the same principles and ethos, although there are some idiosyncrasies and that reflect the unique circumstances of an individual project, of the organization that project's located in, or of the geography that project targets. And we found through the engagements as part of this process, there was a definite or palpable sense of the social prescribing movement. And I suppose that's probably captured in the network of link workers who are now engaging to share learning and practice across Ireland. Some of the specific detail about the projects and how they operate is weaved into and throughout the evaluability assessment, which we address next. So for those that are new to evaluability assessment, I suppose to start off with saying it's not an evaluation. It's more about determining whether or not a credible and reliable evaluation is possible. And the evaluability assessment that we carried out was built on the 3 key pillars of evaluability in principle. So what's the nature of the intervention and the extent to which that intervention has a plausible and theoretically sound theory of change? Evaluability in practice really looks at the availability of data and the systems and the processes that are available to collect that data and any of the challenges associated with data collection. Evaluability usefulness really looks at who cares, who has an interest in evaluation, and what's the extent of that interest. And I suppose those 3 pillars combined enable an evaluability assessment. And again, we're going to take a whistle-stop tour through each of those kind of pillars. So evaluability in principle, what we found was the target groups for projects across Ireland is pretty consistent. Social isolation, anxiety, depression, stress, mild or long-term mental health concerns, and frequent GP attendances were the most common reasons participants engaged with social prescribing. The interventions that were delivered are targeted at the social determinants of health, typically person-centered and non-clinical in nature. We did find some variations in the actual delivery or models for the projects, and specifically the role of the link worker varied from a signposting function through to roles that have a service delivery element. And that service delivery often included facilitating arts and crafts workshops, facilitating walk-in groups, or delivering 8-week therapy courses. And that may have implications for attribution when we talk about evaluation. We found that most link workers are part-time, although during the course of the research, funding from Sláinte Care enabled some to move to full-time roles. Most reported being stretched in terms of the work. The typical number of people engaged by projects or supported by projects is between 60 and 90 per annum. And the length of engagement varies and ranges from 1 to 2 weeks through to 6 to 9 months. I think one of the areas of significance for evaluation was that most projects accepted self-referrals, where there are a few that explicitly don't. I think one thing that came through unanimously, and I can say consistent across all the interviews, was the view that link workers were considered the key mechanism for change within a social prescribing project and are crucial to the social prescribing process. And I think that came through really strongly in the powerful case study that we've just heard. Across the projects, we asked the question, look, what outcomes are you achieving or what outcomes are you reporting on for the participants that you engage? And projects provided 27 different outcomes that are being reported and claimed within social prescribing projects. Most of these outcomes are focused on the individual. Some relate to the health and social care system, and some relate to outcomes for community and voluntary organisations that are part of the social prescribing process. We'll talk a wee bit more about those later on the slides when we get to the minimum data outcomes framework. So for clarity and ease of reference, I suppose we try to convert all of that information from the interviews into a logic model for social prescribing. It's presented on your screen. And we hope that that offers a useful starting point for new or emerging projects, and also a solid reference point for those that are more established. So evaluability in principle, hopefully you're now viewing an image that we're calling an evaluation index. And the purpose of that evaluation index was to try and frame a summary of the conversations about how projects are currently approaching evaluation in Ireland. We wanted to stress again that this is not intended as a method for completing evaluation, nor is it intended to be a progression pathway of evaluation. All approaches to evaluation, I suppose, can be considered valid depending on the purpose and objective of that evaluation, and I think that came through from Dr. Dixon earlier. We found that throughout the engagements that most projects are currently operating between approach one and approach three. About half are using validated, reliable tools to measure impact, although some of those aren't being promoted or recorded or analysed or used in any way. Some are probably a quarter are independently evaluated, but most rely on qualitative case studies and self-developed surveys. For those that we engaged, the majority identified approach three as being a preferred approach for evaluation. And really that involves the use of validated tools and an independent evaluation. Approach four was identified as an aspirational or ideal evaluation. And the difference here is that approach four would include some data relating to the system, the healthcare system, whether that's GP attendances, whether that's emergency department attendances, or reductions in wait lists. Although there are quite a few challenges and barriers associated with accessing that data that may inhibit that approach. So within that, we had mixed feedback in terms of the project's relationships with primary care teams. This was viewed as potentially restricting both referrals to social prescribing projects and access to data that might report on system level changes. We know that projects have finite resources. Like most link workers reported that they're working more hours than contracted. And most organizations that are hosting link workers actually report that they're often operating the service at a loss and trying to find match funding to top up the project. There's a requirement for some capacity building and support around the use of validated tools and evaluation more generally. Whereas a lot of the projects are using quite basic systems to store and collect data, only three are using a purpose-built, a robust system, digital system, and this was identified as a key area for development. I think one of the things that came through time and time again around evaluability and practice was the challenge associated with the lack of clarity about what's expected from evaluation by funders and commissioners. So whilst an approach to evaluation might be fine for a project in terms of identifying outcomes for a participant, identifying service improvements for their own project, or used as a promotional tool to recruit participants or recruit referral agents, for a funder or a commissioner, maybe an approach four or five evaluation is essential, and it looks at value for money. I think clarity on what's expected is going to be key. And again, that's something that we pick up later. The evaluability usefulness was probably an easy one. And I think the interest in evaluation of social prescribing is clear for all to see. For any that were there at the conference in Waterford in December, you would have witnessed my disbelief that we had full attendance at the last session of the day when the topic was evaluation. I think I said I couldn't believe the level of interest in evaluation. I hadn't come across that before. And that level of interest, I have to say, has endured throughout our process. The level of interest in the report was incredible, and the attendance here today is probably testament to that and reinforces this. And just to note that that interest is also shared across sectors. So by social prescribing projects themselves, community and voluntary organizations, statutory organizations, funders, and some primary care professionals. So I suppose all of this combined has enabled us to make a conclusion within the report that social prescribing can be evaluated. An evaluability assessment at this time, we feel, was the right approach by the HSE and the partners that commissioned the report. And with some additional support for the projects And with clarified expectations from funders, we believe that there's potential for good quality evaluation and potential in the longer term for a national evaluation of social prescribing. So moving on to objective three of the report, I suppose in the context of the evaluability assessment and in light of all of the findings that we identified through that, the task was then to develop a minimum data outcomes framework for social prescribing. I mentioned earlier that during the course of our engagements with projects, they told us that about 27 different outcomes that are being reported or claimed at this minute in time. And you can see those on your screen. You'll see clearly that the majority of outcomes that are being recorded at the minute or reported are at the individual or participant level. There are some outcomes at the system and organizational level, but I suppose for us, we want to try and take that a wee bit further. And adopting the principles of consensus-based methodology, we wanted to learn what people felt represented the minimum outcomes that should be measured within a social prescribing process. So we facilitated a co-design workshop attended by 24 people to explore minimum outcomes. We then tested the findings of that further with interviews and small group discussions with other stakeholders involved in social prescribing. And what we really asked participants to clarify was what could be measured, what should be measured, and what must be measured. And that was the framework against which we tested the minimum data outcomes framework. So at the individual level, individual participant level, two key outcomes were identified that were perceived to cut across all social prescribing projects. Those are personal well-being with a focus on mental well-being and social connectedness. So these were found to be consistent across almost all the social prescribing projects we engage with, and therefore crucial and central to the evaluation of social prescribing. Within the minimum data outcomes framework, we've suggested four validated tools that measure personal well-being and social connectedness. Now, we understand that there will be other tools and projects and individual organizations will have preferences. However, we made these recommendations based on feedback from link workers who told us, number one, that a maximum of two validated tools could be used within the evaluation process. There was concern that evaluation could subsume the social prescribing intervention and be counterintuitive to the principles and ethos of what a social prescribing intervention should be. Therefore, any tool that's used should be hopefully short and easy to administer. Given the finite resources available to projects, we were trying to source tools that were ideally be free to use and easily accessible. And where possible, where projects are already using an appropriate validated tool, continuity would be preferred rather than creating change for the sake of it. So that's how we arrived at the tools that we've recommended here. But as I say, we're aware that others will work. At a systems level, i.e. a healthcare systems level, three outcomes were identified as being most important. GP attendance, potential reductions, ED attendance, and a reduction in waiting lists, and specifically mental health waiting lists were identified by stakeholders as a priority. So I've already set out in this presentation that a range of barriers and challenges exist in reporting on these and accessing data relating to these, although there are positive examples of projects that are reporting data in relating to a reduction in mental health waiting lists, for example. I think you find in the report reference to a reduction from 40 to 6 in a mental health waiting list for one social prescribing project and a high degree of attribution allocated to the availability of a link worker in that area. And that's a type of data or process that could be built upon and used. So the minimum data outcomes framework, essentially that we've pulled together in the report, sets out six key steps that support an evaluation design. And the six key steps are set out below. Number one, reference to gathering data on project participants. So this would include demographic information, gender, age, ethnic group, what the presenting issue might be, geography. And most projects are already doing this. They're already gathering this information. We've suggested validated tools that should measure personal well-being and social connectedness. And given the concern about evaluation subsuming an intervention, we've suggested that sampling may be an appropriate approach for projects. So if projects are working with between 60 and 90 individuals per year, gathering data on potentially one in three participants may suffice. And it's likely that this data would have to be gathered by link workers as part of an initial assessment and then at regular intervals. participant case studies, we've seen the power of case studies already today, and we propose that those human stories should absolutely be part of evaluation, ideally as part of an independent evaluation. The framework also suggests an annual survey for primary care professionals and community and voluntary organisations that are connected to the social prescribing process. And finally, we've set out that evaluation would benefit from the use of an appropriate system to collate, store and manage data within projects. And conscious that a lot of this will fall on organisations who have finite resources, so within the framework and within the report, we've set out some templates in the appendices, some resources, and we've also made reference to other positive examples of good evaluation practice, both in Ireland and across the UK, that might provide a guide or useful reference point for the projects as they try to implement and adapt their evaluation practice. And also to note that we understand that all and any outcomes achieved are important to measure. I know Dr. Dixon touched on the kind of movement beyond health-focused funds, looking at works in prison, looking at homelessness. We heard outcomes that were referenced in relation to employability and skills and independence. And all of those outcomes are important. And we would encourage and suggest that if organizations have the capacity to do more, then they should. However, in light of the factors that are influencing evaluation in Ireland currently, the minimum data outcomes framework that's put forward here represents a starting point. We don't anticipate that this will sit still. We imagine it'll grow and evolve alongside the evolution of funding, evolution of projects, and the evolution of further research and the social prescribing. Particularly when there's a randomized control trial underway in Ireland at the minute as well that may contribute significantly to the information that we have around evaluation. So within any report that we pull together, look at the aspiration is that a report has a positive impact. And for this one, we hope it has a positive impact on the evaluation of social prescribing. However, the report is only as good as the action that follows it. And to this end, the report offers five key recommendations. The first two are really focused on further consultation and engagement with primary care teams, GPs, funders, and government departments and bodies beyond those that are just focused on health. And specifically, we believe that those stakeholders should be asked, if a project implements the minimum data outcomes framework as set out and demonstrates positive outcomes, to what extent will it strengthen your view on social prescribing and the likelihood of participating in or supporting social prescribing projects and processes? What can projects do to access additional data that might support evaluation at the system level? And what else beyond the minimum data outcomes framework, if anything, would encourage greater involvement or greater support for social prescribing projects? And we've recommended a series of roundtable discussions take place in that regard. Recommendation 3 proposes a body of support to social prescribing projects, both existing and new, that may include additional resources, either centrally within the HSC or to projects directly, training, support to access validated tools, and support to access appropriate systems to manage data. We know that there's an ongoing work, and it was set out clearly earlier on from Dr. Stephanie O'Keefe around the work that cross departments are involved in around social prescribing. And we've suggested that specific measurable objectives for mainstream and social prescribing with specific timescales and accountable actions be developed and shared. And we've also recommended that the minimum data outcomes framework could be converted to a practical and implementable toolkit that organizations can lift and feel they have a better understanding of how to apply that to their own project, their own organization, and their own area. So all that leaves me to say at this stage is, look, thank you so much for taking the time to listen. I know I can speak for Jennifer at Elemental and our own organization, S3 Solutions, when I say we're really grateful for the opportunity to work on this project, which we know is really important to a lot of people. We'd like to thank everybody that contributed to the report. We hope that you see value in the report and hope that you feel an element of ownership in the findings. Special thanks must go to members of the steering group, Anne Sheridan, Orla Walsh, Gemma Cox, Deirdre Connolly and Sarah Gibney for their invaluable advice and guidance throughout. We really appreciate it. Luckily for me, Jennifer will be on the panel later, so she can deal with any of the difficult questions that you might have about the report. And all I can say is thanks again and hope you enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you very much, Eamon, for that really in-depth presentation actually on the main elements of the report. There's no doubt that the minimum data outcomes framework is going to be an incredibly useful guide to us here in Ireland in terms of how we move forward to support evaluation in social prescribing. I'd like to acknowledge the ready contribution of all of the social prescribing projects who participated in this study. As Eamon said, the interest was palpable, and I think that just enthusiasm suggests that, look, the system is ready to really take forward robust evaluation in social prescribing in Ireland. I'd like to reassure the social prescribing projects and those of you who are centrally involved in those that, look, the report and recommendations that we're launching today is really just the first step in really building this solid evidence base. And in my role as Programme Manager for Mental Health and Wellbeing, and I know my colleagues who work alongside me, that we're really committed to working with you over the coming months to really work together to see how we can ensure that we build this evidence base in the most robust way that we can. So we look forward to taking that forward with you and to supporting you in any practical the report actually names a number of kind of steps that we could take to actually support evaluation. So we look forward to those conversations with you in the months ahead. So it's now my pleasure to, I should also want to say, because Stephanie mentioned the work that's going on within the programme, that we have convened a national steering group to look at and to take forward the idea of mainstreaming social prescribing within the HSE. So this is moving towards a much more sustainable approach to social prescribing. So there's lots happening in this area at the moment, which I'm delighted to say. So it's now my pleasure to welcome a pre-recorded input from Minister Frank Fain, who's the Minister for Health, Minister of State for Public Health, Wellbeing and the National Drug Strategy, who will officially launch this report.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to launch this important report into one of the most exciting and growing areas of healthcare, social prescribing. All of you here today will be familiar with the themes and action areas in the Healthy Ireland framework. At the core of the framework is a recognition that if we are to improve the health of the population, we must take into account the social determinants of health, those key factors that impact upon health and well-being. These include the circumstances which people are born, grown up, live, work and age. The degree to which people are socially connected with friends, family and the wider communities in which they live is a key factor influencing well-being. Social prescribing is one of the means by which we can achieve a greater degree of social connectedness for people and counteract isolation, thereby improving mental health. Additionally, by using social prescribing, if we can empower people to find their own solutions for health and well-being, the potential benefits can be enormous. Social prescribing is a simple and yet profound idea. Linking patients in primary care with sources of support within the community, which can include arts and creativity, physical activity, peer and group support, green activity, men's shed and computerized therapy. Social prescribing is a great example of what can be achieved by taking a holistic approach to healthcare solutions. It very much aligns with the visions of Sláintecare and Healthy Ireland to ensure that more sustainable approaches to the provision of health and social care services are developed into the future. It has been shown to result in positive emotional, cognitive, and social outcomes, especially in reducing social exclusion for disadvantaged, isolated, lonely, and vulnerable people, many of whom experience depression and anxiety. As such, it is a great tool for addressing social isolation and is therefore very much in line with the overall vision of goals of sharing the vision, a mental health policy for everyone, and our national strategy for suicide prevention, connecting for life. The report we are launching today notes that there have been a welcome increase in the number of social prescribing projects in Ireland, and I'm pleased to acknowledge the contribution made here by both the Healthy Ireland and Sláintecare Integration Funds. It is, of course, essential that our disease prevention policies and programmes are designed and implemented on the basis of the best available evidence. And today's report explores the challenges of assessing the impact and potential benefits of social prescribing. It recognises that social prescribing is relatively new to Ireland in comparison to other areas, particularly the UK, and seeks to assess the extent to which social prescribing can be evaluated. This assessment, in turn, is designed to enable informed decisions about whether and how to evaluate a programme or policy in a credible way. The report recognises the challenges involved in gathering outcome data and also important of the linked workers and primary care teams in the process. It describes how a minimum data outcome framework can be used to establish tools, gather baseline data and follow-up data, and set out a number of recommendations for further actions. These include further testings of the proposed minimum data outcome frameworks, discussions with other government departments, providing support to social prescribing programs for evaluation, and defining what mainstreaming of social prescribing might mean, and the development of a practical workbook and toolkit for projects. I have no doubt this report will make a major contribution to the further development of social prescribing in Ireland. It only remains now for me to congratulate and thank the many people who've worked so hard to produce this report. As always, partnership is a key to progress in our health services. And I want to acknowledge and thank our colleagues from the HSE's Health and Wellbeing Division, the National Office for Suicide Prevention, Trinity College, the Research Services and Policy Unit in my department, and the Irish Government Economic and Evaluation Service. Thanks to S3 Solutions and Elemental and to the Social Prescribing Network Ireland for their work in championing and promoting social prescribing. Finally, but perhaps most importantly, I want to thank the many social prescribing projects, resource centres, GP practices, and other local and community resources who gave their time to be interviewed for this project. Your work has helped many people in transforming their lives for the better, and your contribution to this report will help us all see how we can improve and build upon this great work. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Fagan. So now we move to our panel discussion, and I can see that there's been lots of questions coming in from you as an audience. So we'll move on to that right now. And I'd like to welcome on screen our panel for this discussion. And I'll wait till they're all on the screen and then I'll introduce them all. Okay, so maybe as I'm introducing you, you can see people's names. Okay, so first of all, I'll introduce Lisa Seeger Jemison, who is Social Prescribing Coordinator with Southside Partnership, Dunleary Rathdown. You're welcome.
Thank you, Lisa.
And next up is Dr. Michael Dixon, whom you've seen already and heard already, Clinical Lead for Social Prescribing, NHS England. We're delighted, Michael, you can join us for this.
Thanks very much.
Jennifer Neff, sorry?
I recorded because my broadband's so bad, so do forgive me if I come and go a bit.
Yeah, and we're also very impressed that you went and put on the green jumper that you were wearing in the video earlier. Okay, next is Jennifer Neff, who is co-partnered with Eamon Sedak in doing the study and report. So Jennifer, you're welcome. Jennifer's co-founder and co-CEO of Elemental Software. Dr. Philip Dodd. Philip, you're welcome. Philip is clinical advisor in the National Office for Suicide Prevention. And Sarah Gibney, who is acting head of Research Services and Policy Unit, Irish Government and Evaluation Services in the Department of Health. Welcome, Sarah.
Thank you.
Okay, great. So we have a number of questions coming in, but I'm just going to start the conversation really with yourself, Lisa, as someone who's actually delivering social prescribing service. And we can't ignore the fact that COVID-19 has happened and probably has transformed, as it's transformed business for a lot of us, it's probably also transformed business for social prescribing. So will you just tell us a little bit about how has social prescribing responded to COVID-19?
Hello, Anne. Thank you very much, first of all, for inviting me to the panel. It's a pleasure to be here and well done on this report. Your question about how social prescribing in Ireland has responded to COVID-19 is really a good one, because over the last couple of months, I suppose, a lot of the programmes that currently exist in Ireland had to severely adapt to the current environment. And I suppose what is most important here, and I know this from linking in with many of my peers nationally through a social prescribing peer network we have established, is that it really depended as well on what development stage the project was at. So I think this is really important. If you had a social prescribing project that had been in existence for a number of years, those projects, for example, were immediately able to continue to work with their caseload, link in with stakeholders and referrers. But other projects, which have only recently been established, for example, may have been in a difficult situation where, I suppose, they were just in the process of building their relationships as well with GPs, primary care and other referrers, as well as building their caseload. So what has happened there and really across the board is that social prescribing programs have adapted really, really well in that they made a lot of creative new connections, linking in, for instance, with community call initiatives and other groups, in the absence, I suppose, of referrals from GPs or other clinicians. And I suppose it's really important to say here as well that our experience has been that GP referrals in many cases have gone down tremendously at the beginning of this, because of course the footfall has been in those settings. So that's one big thing. The other thing is that I suppose how social prescribers have actually responded or worked with people throughout the pandemic has changed as well. So in terms of, I suppose, not being able to do a traditional one-to-one meeting with somebody, people had to move their engagements online, for example, to platforms that were available to us like this one, or also support over the phone. And it really has been the experience of many of us that the work has intensified. So if you had even been working with somebody who had already been on your caseload, it might have been that there could have been a setback for the person due to higher levels of stress and anxiety. So, you know, but the work has changed, but there have been a lot of creative ideas, like online courses. A lot of the activities have moved online. So
social prescribing has adapted really to be able to respond very well to the situation. In terms of evaluation, what are the challenges you think that COVID-19 posed for evaluation?
Yeah, I suppose many of us have a methodology that we currently use. Some of it would be in line with what has been presented here and some of it is different, but there definitely is a situation where the social prescribing programs across the country might be operating slightly differently. And we have asked the peers, I suppose, in our own network, how they have adapted during COVID-19 in terms of their own methodology. And it was very clear that there were challenges there because the original methodology might have not necessarily worked in the current situation. So some projects may have adapted their methodology. They might have added questions. Some projects have actually stopped measuring in the same way at the start because just the types of things that participants were presenting with were very different. But the challenge really is now as well to capture the impact of COVID-19. This report here, of course, was started, and I suppose the minimum outcomes framework was really created, you know, pre-COVID in one sense. So now the challenge really is to look at how that can be embedded, but also how we can capture what is happening now.
Okay, so that has to become an added dimension really in evaluation really for the moment. Jennifer, anything you'd like to add to that?
Yeah, thanks, Anne. In terms of capturing the impact, yeah, it's one of the themes, I suppose, in the outcomes framework is around the organisation. And what we've seen is that that information is more important than ever. So where are referrals coming from? What are they for? What do people need help with? What services are available? So what we've seen is a lot more effort is going into that because that gives you a really true reflection of where the demand is and the type of things that social prescribing are able to help with. So like Lisa says, some people are relaxing you know, they're not doing the 7 or the 10 questions as part of the well-being score. Some people are still doing that, you know, they might measure anxiety, for example. So depending on, you know, what the kind of need is in the neighborhood or the locality. But yeah, it's really, really important now, I suppose, for people to still be able to show the demand for the service, because, you know, if you're wanting to show if GP referrals have reduced, for example, you know, there still is a need there. So how can we make it easier for people to self-refer themselves into the link workers? So we start to see a lot more creativity about enabling people to self-refer themselves and say exactly what they need. And then the link workers, it's showing the difference that the link workers are making. All too often, I suppose, in the past, we might have thought when an evaluation happens, it's evaluating the impact of the walking group or the men's shed. But what we've learned and what's coming through really strongly in this report, it's the impact of the link workers and the service that's been provided, because so much time goes into the work that the link workers do. They're looking around to find out what's available. They're helping people. They're going through. They have a lot of admin to do as well, which really, you know, restricts them then on how many people they can support. So it's all about making that as easy as possible. Case studies are still going to be really important as well. I know we're talking about that later on, but you know, you'll have some stats that are coming through in terms of showing demand and your own capacity to be able to cater for the demand that's out there, but also the use cases are coming through as well. There's some great examples.
Okay, thanks for that, Jennifer. Philip, you want to come in there?
Yeah, just thanks so much, Anne. And just very briefly, congratulations to everyone for bringing this piece of work to this particular point on behalf of NOSP, the National Office for Suicide Prevention. We have, I suppose, a history in being very supportive of the development of social prescribing over the last number of years. And we see it as a very important part of, I suppose, our mental health service offering in Ireland. And I suppose we celebrate the fact that social prescribing is so prominent in our new national mental health policy, sharing the vision. The reason I was just interjecting there is really to just maybe give a brief insight into the national psychosocial response within the HSE to COVID-19. So we're in the process of finalising, a very enhanced framework to understand this and to deliver on the psychosocial responses with regard to COVID. I think COVID has had an unexpected, opportunity to emphasise the importance of psychosocial responses and supports for the whole population as we're faced with something like a pandemic. Mm-hmm. And I think when the framework is published, which is likely to be within the next 4 to 8 weeks, hopefully, it will be an opportunity at a regional and a national level for relevant projects to come forward in a way that they will be able to project what they're trying to deliver, maybe give a sense of the evaluation of the services that they're delivering in a way then to develop business cases to enhance the potential offering of services in local areas. So that's really just the additional point I was hoping to make.
So great. So yeah, that's an opportunity, kind of another opportunity for social prescribing, really. Thanks, Philip. One of the emerging issues, I think, that's arising, not just in relation to social prescribing, but more generally now, is the whole issue of digital inequalities or digital poverty. And Michael, you mentioned this in your presentation earlier on, and I'm just wondering, how is the UK managing that? Or is there, you know, what's the response to try to counteract and to deal with the digital poverty that's arising?
Well, I think, first of all, a lot of these social prescribing schemes are developing various apps that people can directly connect with, both as
we're having BB broadband issues there, Anne, if you want to move on.
Okay, so
those facilities. And I think just at the beginning, the foothills of trying to realise that's a problem and need sorting. Mm. Initiatives trying to help link workers to get connected, because one problem in the UK is a lot of the link workers don't actually have tablets and they don't have connection to surgery systems, nor do they have mobile. So that's almost our first base. But in my own town, for instance, we're looking, we have a children's initiative where we're looking at the children using their digital knowledge to go to the elderly and provide them with input. And it's interesting interesting situation, because the children in our town have said that the most important thing they would like to improve their quality of life would be volunteering opportunities. So there are lots
There's
of
perfect.
Things
to yeah. add there.
Yeah.
That can happen.
And could I add something?
Yes, Lisa.
Just to quickly say as well, just in line with this, obviously, I did mention that a lot of social prescribers, you know, are obviously delivering their one-to-ones online, but also a lot of group work is happening online. And of course, a lot of the activities that people might get referred to are now online. Yeah. But there is a definite issue there with a lot of the people that are linking into social prescribing not actually having access to IT equipment, or maybe don't have the skills. Mm. Definitely been an experience. And the second thing really is that some people also are experiencing, well, we talk about digital fatigue now. So mm-hmm. you might have programs available online, but people are really yearning to go back outside. So it's a huge issue as well to sort of keep reinventing as well from yeah. a social prescribing point of view, and to keep remapping as well what's in the community. So it's just a huge piece as well around, I suppose, the importance of the community and voluntary sector in this, being linked into this all the time.
Yeah, okay, great. Okay, thanks, Lisa. Michael, I'm going back to you for a minute, if we still have you there. And just back to the evaluation issue, really, I'm wondering, in your experience, how has good quality evaluation impacted on the growth of social prescribing in the UK, and particularly in terms of encouraging the buy-in of clinicians like GPs?
That's a fascinating question. I mean, I think the important thing to begin with was to show that it reduced use on the health service for the policymakers. And the 20% reduction in GP use and use of emergency departments was, I think, a big factor in it becoming a comprehensive movement amongst the politicians. I won't say it was everything, because I think actually a lot of people have just intuitively said, well, it's an obviously a good idea, and we've been very lucky in the UK to get that leadership right the way down the system. For the clinicians, we're hypocrites as clinicians. We always say we go by evidence, but actually we're as emotional and right brain as anyone else, and our own patients. So I think for some, it's been very important showing the improvement, but actually a lot of it is seeing and believing. It's actually seeing when it comes to your neck of the woods that your patients are better, they're not seeing you as often, and all the rest of it. So I think the evidence and evaluation is crucial, because not only is it pushing the political field towards social prescription, but also it's telling us, you know, exactly where is social prescription going to be most effective, in what cases, for what patients, with what interventions.
Yeah, okay, great. Philip, just to go to you on that, and thinking about how we start to capture the system level evaluation and looking at opportunities to do that. Any thoughts on that?
Well, it's. I think it's a huge challenge to do that. I think getting an agreed evaluation minimum data set, I think, is a really good start. I think evaluation has multiple different purposes. One of the reasons is obviously to evaluate the impact that the intervention has on the individual, and that's very important. But it also is a means by which we can, I suppose, as a sector, represent the potentially transformative effects of social prescribing on individuals, both at a personal level, but also at a system level. And it's something that I really enjoyed in the report, that it broke down the various levels of evaluation. I know for Sharing the Vision, it also has an outcome. So Sharing the Vision, our new national mental health policy, it has a very significant focus on outcomes. So our previous mental health policy's Vision for Change had quite an emphasis on inputs. So very much describing what we needed in our health service from a service provision point of view, with little enough emphasis on how do we actually ensure that what we've inputted actually has an impact on people's lives. So I think we're probably, our lexicon and our understanding of outcomes, I think, is improving, and evaluation is improving. I think we as a national service provision agency, we need to get our head better around how we capture that at a national level. And unfortunately, I personally don't have any solutions to that for social. I think we need to think it through at a national level, on lots of different levels, in addition to social prescribing.
Okay, thanks, Philip. Sarah, on to you for a moment. I mean, I suppose it's a fundamental question about research, really, is like from a research perspective, how important is it that evaluation is stitched in from the very start, basically, in the design of a project and, you know, from a funding perspective. So can you say a little bit about that, please?
Thanks, Anne. Yeah, that's a very good question. I suppose if we're thinking about, you know, putting our evaluation hats on at the beginning and all the way through, I suppose one of the biggest challenges that we face in evaluation is not having the resources in place, not having the data, be it qualitative or quantitative, for the capacity to capture that, and also not having the research questions or the evaluation questions set. And I think what this report shows is that there's a common logic, there's a common approach, and there's a shared understanding that there is an enormous capacity already there in the system. And there's also, you know, the capacity to deliver on an outcomes framework and lots of good practice already there. So if we think of evaluation as this process, so what are we looking at? We're thinking who's involved in capturing the data, assessing what resources are there, setting those research questions, making sure that the measures are sufficient and are feasible. So if you were to start that for a practice or for a program that's very mature, it's very resource intensive.
Yeah.
And there's also added complexity where a program or a practice has changed over time. And COVID is a very good example of that. We've already heard about the change, you know, moving to more digital practices and engagement. So capturing that complexity and that context is really important. So again, if we start that process early and we structure that thinking and we can be agile with it, it's really the way to go, and you can build in changes and adapt and build out your evaluation approach as service matures.
Yeah, okay, great. That makes a lot of sense. The minimum data outcomes framework that we heard about today is focused a good bit on quantitative data. What about qualitative data? What's your view about how that can be collected?
Sure. So again, picking up on that piece around context. So it's very powerful when you combine quantitative and qualitative data. So in terms of, you know, practice like social prescribing, we want to understand, you know, what's working, in what context, for whom, and what's different. So where you introduce qualitative information, particularly when we were talking about systems level and organizational level, that really helps gain insight into how does it work, what are the processes underway, and that can be really powerful in understanding and getting much richer insight into the quantitative data that you're collecting. So I think it's about being careful about combining different types of data and being very specific in why are you collecting this measure in this way, and being very focused on the logic and what you're intending to capture. I think there can be a tendency from time to time to gather a large amount of qualitative data, which is very important, but it's also can be very time consuming to analyze. You need a lot of resources to do it. So being strategic in capturing qualitative data that complements the quantitative data is perhaps a very powerful way to go.
Yeah, okay. Jennifer, you mentioned case studies as being really important in terms of capturing some of that qualitative data. Would you like to say any more about that?
In terms of, I think what we need now is, you know, we've got the buy-in from everyone delivering social prescribing and HSE, and it's about using the case studies now to get more ministers buy-in, more GPs, secondary care, social care, housing, for example. We're seeing lots of different people in the UK, like as Dr. Michael said, even in Belfast, there's a social prescribing prison. There's another one being adopting social prescribing in Staffordshire. There's universities, for example, in Wales that are now social prescribing universities. One of the further and higher education colleges here in the north is going to be a social prescribing higher education provider. So it's those case studies are powerful. And I always remember Debs Taylor a number of years ago. Her story was so strong, a bit like the story that we heard earlier, very similar. And when you heard the Minister for Health and Matt Hancock in England talking about Debs, you know, that story was the thing that really helped get the importance of social prescribing. And, you know, it's no surprise shortly after that then that there was funding being made for social prescribing link workers. So I think you can never underestimate the power of the person's story and the impact.
Yeah. Absolutely. Philip,
Yeah, and just to briefly add, I think case studies also shed a light on the impact, the potential impact of social prescribing on maybe groups of our population that may not have as clear a voice in I suppose, indicating that they may benefit. So for example, I'm thinking of people with intellectual disability, you know, social connectedness for people with intellectual disability is such an important part of their well-being. That sense of a valued social role is a very, I suppose, respected concept in services to support people with intellectual disability. So transferring that over to a case study, for example, where one would utilize and see the benefits of social prescribing would seem obvious. Again, I'd agree with Jennifer, parts of the population in prisons needing access to psychosocial responses to the, any difficulties they may present, it's a really important intervention that we need to support.
Great. Lisa? You're on mute, Lisa.
My apologies.
I'm just so pleased I was not the person who did that today.
That was probably my most important point now, but... Anyway, I just wanted to say from the point of view of somebody based in a community development organization, and our program is embedded in this piece. I also wanted to just add that this minimum outcomes framework is very interesting in terms of focusing on the individual's experience going through social prescribing. But I also think it's really important, and that could be part of case studies as well, to look at this person as part of the community. And I suppose one needs to see that the majority of social prescribing programs in Ireland at the moment are actually delivered by community development organizations, whether being family resource centers or partnership companies. Of course, there are others, but I suppose the focus or the reason why some of these organizations embarked on this journey was probably a little bit bigger as well. So I think it's just really important to take that wider context as well. And look at, obviously, the social determinants of health have a lot to do with how a person links in with their own community. And all of our organizations would be looking at building and sustaining a healthy community. So this fits right in. But I suppose just in terms of capturing data, for example, we would also be looking at, and Elemental would probably confirm that, at, I suppose, what community assets are actually available in the community and where there are gaps and opportunities. So I just wanted to add that because I know the minimum outcomes framework is very much looking at the individual, but there is a lot more to a lot of these projects that we are running at the moment, especially in COVID-19.
Okay, thank you, Lisa. Michael, how does this conversation around evaluation resonate with the approach to evaluation in the UK?
Well, I think you're right.
Oh. We just lost him.
Patient, what the link worker actually does in practice. I think we have a common evaluator look during COVID especially. A lot of people are actually going their own way and it's not quite as uniform as we hoped. And what I'm taking from today is that Southern Ireland, you know, the Republic is really right ahead of the game. This morning, we were, I should add, planning our international conference on the 4th or 5th of March, and I was showing them your report, and they said, well, we must have Southern Ireland as a chief guest on that conference.
Fabulous. Right. Well, that will be great. Okay. We are coming, I'm just aware of the time, and we are coming near the end. Just to put out to the panel, is there anybody who would like to add anything else at this point?
There's been lots and lots of questions in the Q&A. We're very busy answering them in the background, and all the panelists have been answering as well. I've just picked a couple there that you might like to look at. There's a great question in from Etna. How do you see social prescribers interacting with professionals on community mental health teams?
Okay, that's one for Philip.
Yeah, I spotted that question earlier. I think it's a really important consideration. I think sometimes people consider social prescribing as simply something to be provided to people with more, minor problems, more minor difficulties. I'm not saying that that's what I think, but I think that is a general view by a lot of professionals in the health service. I think people with severe mental health problems could significantly benefit, obviously, from social prescribing approaches and social prescribing options. Within our own mental health services, I think how that could potentially develop is through the growing number of peer support workers that mental health services are employing, and also through some of the structures that have developed in our mental health services through mental health engagement. So we have a national structure of mental health engagement, we have a national lead in mental health engagement, and then in each of our community health organisations, there's a local lead in mental health engagement. I would have thought through those parts of the spoke of the wheel of mental health, it's probably the most logical path into enhancing local social prescribing practices and options. It's also a potential funding path as well, because if obviously, unfortunately, our health system is somewhat siloed in the way in which funding is provided. So any time where we can look to develop funding options across different care sectors, I think it's always an advantage.
Hey, Jennifer?
Yeah, I was just going to quickly say a really good model to look at is the Merseycare Foundation Trust in Liverpool. And they have they receive referrals in from about, I think it's about 30 or 40 different GP practices, and they have escalation pathways. So if someone has a more complex need that is more than what the link worker can be able to support, there's an escalation pathway for that person and for that link worker as well, because it's as much about safeguarding the link worker too in those types of situations.
Okay, great. Lisa?
I just wanted to add as well that, again, in conversation with a lot of my peers, these relationships have been different on local levels, I suppose, and it very much depends as well on building good relationships with the teams in your area. The same could go for linking in with primary social care, social work, apologies. So, you know, it would be great, I suppose, to have some clarification and support nationally to make this happen. But so far, really, the relationship building from the social prescriber with those teams has been crucial.
Okay, and what I can say about that is that the work that we're doing in terms of trying to look at, you know, how to mainstream social prescribing within the HSE is exactly about this. It's about how to engage with those clinical services to have safe and good pathways into social prescribing. So we're on the journey, but just not quite there yet. Jennifer, one last comment.
Just emphasising the importance of the buy-in. There's some fantastic examples out there. If you're wanting to get your GPs and some of your social workers and different multidisciplinary teams involved, there's Dr. Mohan Sekram on Twitter. Have a look at what he's doing. He's creating fantastic videos, him and the link worker together, the patients talking about it. So it's a really good resource if you're wanting a little bit of inspiration to share with some of your local primary care teams.
Okay, folks, I'm just aware we've actually gone over, we're just about to go over time by a few minutes, but that's a good sign that we've held you all on until now. So for now, I would just like to really sincerely thank all of our panelists here today. Thank you very much for participating in that. I know there's been lots of questions that Leo mentioned that have come in. You heard from Leo at the very start that a report will be written which will include all the questions with answers to them, and that will be circulated out to everybody. So if your question wasn't answered today, you will get an answer very shortly. So again, thank you very much to all of the panelists. Thank you to all of the speakers and all of the contributors here today. It's been a really, really fabulous hour and a half, and I think hopefully you've all enjoyed the participation of everybody and hearing. And I suppose what's happening here is it's just a groundswell of support, I think, for proceeding now with really sound evaluation methodology and process around social prescribing. And I certainly look forward to supporting that in any way that I can. Behind the scenes today, I just want to say there was a security blanket, for me anyway, in the names of Leo, Earl and Shane. I'd like to thank all of the team from Integrated Media Solutions for their technical support and backup to this event today, which I think went very smoothly. To my own colleagues, Orla Walsh, Project Manager for Mental Health and Wellbeing, who literally project managed this event today. She organized. She was in touch with all of you, sending out details and all the rest. But just her attention to detail is fantastic. And she's done a brilliant job, as always. I'd also like to acknowledge Noreen Turley, who's Communications Manager in Health and Wellbeing, for all the support, direction, and the injections of good humour she gave along the way as well. But so, folks, if we could give you a round of applause, we would. But I just wanted to thank the entire team who's involved in putting this event together today. And one last thanks to all of you for agreeing to participate and for your contributions. So, and thanks then to the audience who are out there. I can't see you, but thank you. And I really hope that you enjoyed the morning. And as we said, we will issue a report with answers to any of the questions that that you submitted. And thanks for being very active throughout the webinar and sending in your chat and your questions. And we look forward to catching up again another time. So thank you very much, everybody.